Good morning, Wanda. In the last class, we had discussed briefly about discrete Fourier series. This is an analysis equation for DFS, and this is a synthesis equation. And we saw that both of them are periodic with a period of capital N. These two are periodic sequences with a period of capital N. Today, we are going to discuss about discrete Fourier transform. In the short form, that's called as DFT. And we'll try to see how to find the response of an LTI system with the help of DFT. Suppose if the input is x of n and output is y of n, then y of n should be linear convolution of x of n and h of n, right? Where h of n is the impulse response of the system. After finding the linear convolution directly, we'll try to get the help of DFT to compute the linear convolution in the indirect manner. We'll try to see how we are going to do that and which is computationally efficient, that may require less computations as compared to direct linear convolution. You can save so many computations. Let's look into DFT, discrete Fourier transform. Consider a finite length sequence x of n of length n samples such that x of n equals 0 outside the range 0 to n minus 1. In many instances, the length of the sequence is m, which is less than or equals to n, but we want to make it like length n. In such scenarios, you can try to append zeros, right? You can simply try to add zeros from m to capital N minus 1. You can append zeros, right? And you can try to call it like x of n of length n after appending zeros, after appending n minus m zeros. And this can be made like a periodic sequence with period of capital N with this expression, right? X tilde of n equals to sigma r x of n minus rn. You can see this will repeat for every n interval. For every n interval, this will repeat, right? Now this is a periodic signal with a period of n, capital N. This is a periodic. This is periodic with period n. And the finite length sequence x of n can be recovered from x tilde of n as follows. You can simply consider x tilde of n from 0 to n minus 1 and equate to 0 for others. That's it. That's what we are doing here, right? We're just extracting one period of this one, which is from 0 to n minus 1. That is exactly the same as x of n. And let's recall that DFS coefficients of x tilde of n are samples spaced in frequency by 2 pi by n, right? Of the DTFT. We have seen this, right? Since x of n is assumed to have finite length, there is no overlap between the terms x of n minus rn for different values of r. So we can have this expression x tilde of n equals to x of n modulo n. X of n modulo n. This is same as remainder. You are dividing small n with capital N, and the remainder we are going to get, that is same as n modulo n. We can write like this one. For our convenience, we'll try to go for this notation. This is n modulo n. Let's cross check this with an example. Consider an example periodic sequence with a period of 6, n equal to 6 in this case. You can see this. This is x tilde of 0, x tilde of 1, x tilde of 2, x tilde of 3, x tilde of 4, x tilde of 5. This is 0 to n minus 1, right? N minus 1 means 5. And this is x tilde of 6. You can see this is repeating, right? 0 to n minus 1 will repeat for every n interval. This keeps on repeating, right? Periodic pattern. And this corresponds to x tilde of minus 1, x tilde of minus 2, x tilde of minus 3, and so on. And it's a constant x of n. You see, over the interval 0 to n minus 1. we can say this. This is 0, this is n minus 1. Up to this we can start. This is one period, right? Up to this. And remaining all are zeros, including n. This also we are making zeros, right? 0 to n minus 1 will try to cover interval capital N. Let's try to see this. X tilde of 3 equals to x of 3 modulo 6. This should be satisfied according to that earlier expression. Let's cross check this one. See, if you divide 3 with 6, the remainder you are going to get is 3, right? That means that is same as x of 3 itself. We want to cross check this, right? This is x of n, this is x tilde of n. Let's go to x tilde of 3. 0, 1, 2, 3. This is 0, 1, 2, 3. This is x tilde of 3. And this is x of 3. You can see both are equal, right? 0, 1, 2, 3. The two values are equal. It's fine. Let's go for x tilde of 6. This is x tilde of 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is x tilde of 6. This is x tilde of 6. According to this one, that should be x of 6 modulo 6. The remainder of 6 divided by 6 is 0, right? That means that should be same as x of 0. You can see this one is same as this x of 0, right? Both are equal. That means it worked out. And x tilde of 8 equals to x of 8 modulo 6. The remainder of 8 divided by 6 is 2, right? 2 is the remainder. That means this should be equal to x of 2. Let's consider x tilde of 8 in this one. This is x tilde of 5, x tilde of 6, x tilde of 7, x tilde of 8. This is x tilde of 8. That should be equal to x of 2, right? 0, 1, 2. This is x of 2. You can see this one is same as this one, right? The two are same. And x tilde of 13 equals to x of 13 modulo 6. 13 modulo 6 means the remainder of 13 divided by 6 corresponds to 1, right? That should be same as x of 1. Similarly, you can do for the negative side also. X tilde of minus 2 equals to x of minus 2 modulo 6. This can be written like this also. X of minus 2 plus 6 modulo 6. The two are same. Because 6 is the period, right? Here n equal to 6. We are simply adding n to this one. That's it. There is no problem with that. We can simply add plus n to this. Still that remains same. Then this will be x of 4 modulo 6. X of 4 modulo 6 means that is same as x of 4. Should be x of 4. And x of x tilde of minus 21 equals to x of minus 21 modulo 6. Here you can try to write like this, which is same as x of minus 21 plus 4 into, this is n, capital N. It's a period, right? We can go for any integer multiple of period. Still that remains same. You can add any integer multiple of that particular period n, which is same as x of 3. And in general, this is valid by default. Okay, if you want, you can cross check with the figure also. X tilde of minus 2 corresponds to this, right? X tilde of minus 1, x tilde of minus 2. And x of 4 corresponds to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. This is 4, right? You can see this one is exactly equals to this one, right? These two are identical. These values. In general, x tilde of n equals to x tilde of n plus rn, which is same as x of n plus rn modulo n, where r can be any integer, positive or negative or 0. This is due to periodicity, right? This x tilde of n is periodic with the period of capital N. Due to periodicity, we can write like this one. After that, you can go for modulo operation. We already saw that the sequence of DFS coefficients x tilde of k of the periodic sequence x tilde of n is itself a periodic sequence with period n, right? we saw that extended layoff n is periodic period n. Extended layoff k also periodic period n, right? To maintain a duality between the time and frequency domains, we will choose the Fourier coefficients that we associate with a finite duration sequence to be finite duration sequence corresponds to one period of extended layoff k. This finite duration sequence x of k will be referred to as the DFT. The DFT coefficients are x of k equals to x tilde of k over the interval 0 to n minus 1 and equal to 0 otherwise. That means we are simply extracting one period of x tilde of k and we are calling it like DFT coefficients x of k. That's what we are doing. That's it. And x tilde of k also can be written like this one. That is same as x of k modulo n. It's something similar to earlier, right? X tilde of n equals to x of n modulo n. There also periodic period n, here also periodic period n, right? Both are similar. And this is DFS, the other DFS coefficients, discrete Fourier series coefficients. X tilde of k equal to sigma n equals 0 to n minus 1, X tilde of n, double n power k n, where double n equals 3 power minus j 2 pi by capital N. And this is the synthesis equation. This is the analysis equation. As the summation involves only from the interval 0 to n minus 1, we can write as follows. X of k equals to sigma n equals 0 to n minus 1, x of n w n power k n 0 to n minus 1, k from 0 to n minus 1, that is equal to 0 otherwise. Because as you said, DFT is nothing but one interval of x tilde of k, right? 0 to n minus 1. We are considering x tilde of k over 0 to n minus 1. And we already know that x tilde of n equals to x of n in the interval 0 to n minus 1, right? Both are identical. We are simply replacing x tilde of n with x of n in the interval 0 to n minus 1. That's what we are doing here. That's it. You can see this. Replacing x tilde of n with x of n straight away. And we already know that x tilde of k in the interval 0 to n minus 1, we are calling it like x of k, right? That means for k equal to 0 to n minus 1, we can simply replace x tilde of k with x of k. That's it. That's what we had done. Similarly, we can have x of n equals to synthesis equation 1 by n sigma k equals 0 to n minus 1 x of k double n power minus k n where n from 0 to n minus 1. What we are doing here is we are just considering one period of x tilde of n and one period of x tilde of k. That's what we are doing. This straightforward. It's a DFT analysis equation. And this is the synthesis equation for the DFT. Or you can say, this is inverse DFT, IDFT. This is DFT. We already seen in the DFS case, that is simply a sampled version of DTFT, right? At every interval of 2 pi by k. At every infra interval we are sampling, right? We introduce some notation like omega suffix k, which is equal to 2 pi k by capital N. We are simply sampling it for every omega equals 2 pi k by N. DFT also same thing, right? You can observe clearly. Because the expressions look same, right? Identical for both of them. The inherent periodicity is always present. Because you can see, if you want, you can cross check here. Simply substitute k k plus capital N in place of k in both sides, then you are going to end up with the same expression, which is same as x of k. And you can try with N plus capital N here, both sides. And if you try to simplify this, you are going to end up with same x of N. It means the inherent periodicity still is there. Sometimes it causes difficulty and sometimes we can exploit it. But to totally ignore, it is to invite a trouble. That means don't forget that inherent periodicity is there in DFT also. In defining the DFT representation, we are simply recognizing that we are interested in values of x of n only in the interval 0 to n minus 1. Because x of n is really 0 outside that interval. That's why you want to focus in only that interval, right? 0 to n minus 1 interval. And we are interested in values of x of k only in the interval 0 to n minus 1, because these are the only values needed to reconstruct x of n. See, because if you are able to reconstruct x of n with the help of 0 to n minus 1 samples of x of k, then no need to bother about other samples, right? That means for DFT, we will try to consider only x of n from 0 to n minus 1 and x of k from 0 to n minus 1 interval. Let's have a look into example. Let's consider some rectangle pulse with n equal to 5, period n equals to 5. That means 0 to n minus 1. This is 0 to n minus 1. That is equals to 1. We are considering 0 to n minus 1 equals to 1. And after that, this is always equal to 0. That means over that entire period, this is always equal to 1, right? N minus 1 means 4. This is x of n. And if you are trying to construct equivalent periodic signal with a period of n equal to 5, we will try to repeat this pattern for every interval of 5. You have seen that, right? X tilde of n is simply equal to sigma r x of n plus rn, right? You can keep on repeating that one. If you repeat that pattern, this is 0 to 4 interval. This will cover 5, right? 5 samples. Just repeat it after that. If you repeat that one, you are going to get continuous sequence of 1s, right? We try to apply DFT for this, discrete Fourier transform. This is the DFT. See, DFT coefficients are same as DFS coefficients over the interval 0 to n minus 1, right? Both are identical. That's what we are doing here. S tilde of k equals to sigma n x of n e power minus j 2 pi k n by n. And we already know that S tilde of n is same as x of n in the interval 0 to n minus 1, right? Both are same. And which is equals to 1. And you are going to end up with this expression. S tilde of k equals to 5 for k is integer multiple of 5, right? And that's equals to 0 otherwise. And let's have the graphical view of that one. See, this particular thing corresponds to mod x of e power j omega. It's a DTFT. DTFT for the rectangle pulse. It's a DTFT for the rectangle pulse, right? Where x of n equals to 1 from 0 to 4 interval. We are applying discrete time Fourier transform, DTFT for this one, which is same as sigma n x of n e power minus j omega n, right? Then you are going to get DTFT, which is x of e power j omega. For that, we are finding the magnitude spectrum. The magnitude spectrum of the DTFT we are going to get with that given x of n. Now we can try to observe this clearly. DFT or DFS, which is same as sampling this DTFT at every interval of 2 pi k by capital N, right? Or at every interval of 2 pi by capital N, you are sampling this one. And you can see clearly, right? We are sampling at this point. After that, this corresponds to 2 pi by N, this gap, and this corresponds to one more 2 pi by N. See, 2 pi into 2 by N, 2 pi into 3 by N, 2 pi into 4 by N, and 2 pi into 5 by N. You can cross check, right, if you want. 2 pi into 5 by N, where N equal to 5 here, right, in this case. 5 gets cancelled out, and you are going to end up with 2 pi. And you can see periodicity of DDFT also there, right? See, periodic with period of 2 pi. The same pattern is repeating for DDFT, this particular thing also. You can see that. You are sampling at every 2 pi by N. You see, well, first sample, second, third, fourth, fifth sample. Like this, you are sampling. That's it. These are the DFS coefficients. These samples are the DFS coefficients. And for the DFT coefficients, we'll consider over one interval of HTLA of K. That's it. It means 0 to 4, right? 0 to n minus 1 means you'll consider from 0 to 4. This interval will try to reproduce. You have only one non-zero thing at 0, right? Which is equal to 5. This is called as DFT coefficients, x of k. And after that, we are equating to 0 by default. Let's consider the same rectangle pulse once again. But try to make N to be 10, capital N to be 10. Earlier, we consider N equal to 5. N equal to 5 means then after converting into periodic pattern, we got once everywhere, right? You are repeating that for every N equal to 5. In this case, you are repeating this pattern for every N equals to 10. That means you'll try to, this will be shifted to 10, right? Earlier, this 0 shifted to 5. Now this 0 will be shifted to 10 because you are repeating for every 10, right? This will be shifted to this 10 location. And this side, this will be shifted to minus 10, this 0. And this will repeat, right? This is a periodic pattern. Now this is a periodic pattern we are considering. If you try to apply DFS for this one, we are going to end up with this one. Here the DFS coefficients over one period, like 0 to n minus 1 means 0 to 9 interval, 0 to 9. You can try to see this clearly, right? That is same as sampling DTFT, x of e power j omega at frequencies of omega k equals to 2 pi k by 10. This is 2 pi k by n, right? Earlier you are sampling x of e power j omega at every 2 pi k by 5. Now we are sampling same x of e power j omega with less interval, right? With an interval of 2 pi by 10. For every 2 pi by 10 interval, we are sampling this one. Earlier, we sampled for every 2 pi by 5. Let's have a look into this. With 0, this interval is 2 pi by 5. And this interval corresponds, this to this interval corresponds to 2 pi by 10. Now we are going to get one more sample at this. And this is 2 pi 2 by 10, which is same as 2 pi by 5. This is 2 pi 3 by 10. That means we are going to have one extra sample here, another extra sample here, and one more extra sample here, one more extra sample here, and one more extra sample here. You can see the same thing in this. Between here, extra samples, right? This one and this one. These are the extra samples we got. Earlier, you got only this one, and this one, right? Now, we got these extra samples. Because you are sampling that mod x of e power j omega at every omega k equals to 2 pi k by 10 instead of 2 pi k by 5. It means, in both of these cases, we are sampling same x of e power j omega, but in second case, you are trying to sample that with a small interval gap, right? You are trying to sample more times compared to first one. It's somewhat finer sampling in the second case. First one is somewhat coarser sampling. That's the only difference. That means just with zero padding, indirectly that's like zero padding, right? With help of zero padding, you can try to go for more number of samples in DFT. Let's say I look into circular shift of a sequence. Let us consider n point DFT pair x of n leads to x of k. X of k is the DFT coefficients. Let x1 of k equals to e power minus j2 pi k by n into m into x of k, which is same as w n power m into x of k, we are multiplying with some complex exponential, right? In the frequency domain. The frequency domain. Then you can try to guess, right? What will happen? And you can try to map to DDFT. Suppose if I try to multiply with e power minus j omega n naught, what I'm going to do is e power minus j omega n naught into x of e power j omega. This is with respect to DDFT. The inverse transform for that one will be delayed version of x of n, right? X of n minus n naught. Something similar behavior we can observe here also. But this time that will be circular shift. That won't be like a linear shift like that one. It's a circular shift. Then the inverse DFT for this one corresponds to x of n minus m modulo n. You can see this extra effect we are getting for DFT, right? When you look into DDFT, there we have not seen the circular shift. There we simply got x of n minus m kind of thing. But here, it's a circular shift. Again, remember this one. This is not linear shift. This is a circular shift. X of n minus m modulo n. Let's have a look into circular shift of finite length sequence. Some example. Let's consider some x of n like this 0 to n minus 1 interval. And this is the constant x tilde of n. If you try to repeat this for every n interval, 0 will be coming to n location. You can see this. And this 0 will be going to minus n location this way. This is minus n. And this is a periodic pattern. And just consider shifting the sequence left side by two samples, right? You can see this one. X1 tilde of n equals to x tilde of n plus 2. This is x tilde of n. You are trying to shift this left side by two samples. You try to shift this left side by two samples. What's happening is 0 will be shifted to location minus 2, right? This is minus 2. And this 2 will be shifted to location 0, right? This 2 will be shifted to location 0. You can see this. This 2 shifted to location 0, right? Here. And x1 of n equals to x1 tilde of n from 0 to n minus 1 interval. Once you do this operation over this periodic sequence, then you can simply try to extract this part 0 to n minus 1 interval in this part in the shifted version. That is same as circular shift operation. This is same as circular shift operation, which is equivalent to x of n plus 2 modulo n. X of n plus 2 modulo n. That is same as x of n plus 2 modulo n. That means circular shift is same as shifting periodic sequence and after that considering over one period 0 to n minus 1. Both of them are identical, circular shift and this one. If you want, you can try to apply circular shift directly with the help of this modulo n operation, where n in this case is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Here n equal to 6. If you want, you can try to apply this modulo n operation. With the help of this one, you can try this. You are going to end up with this same expression. You can cross check that. Circular convolution. Circular convolution is same as one period of periodic convolution output. That means you will do periodic convolution, and after that you will try to extract 0 to n minus 1 interval in that convolved output. That same as circular convolution. It means if you try to apply circular convolution for two sequences which are having length of capital N, after circular convolution you are going to end up with the same length N. We are considering both sequences to be of same length, capital N. Even after circular convolution, the length we are going to get also same, capital N only. But when coming to linear convolution, that's something different, right? If you want, you can consider two sequences of different length, there's no problem at all. For example, if you consider N1 and N2 as length of the two sequences, where N1 need not be equal to N2 in case of linear convolution. After linear convolution, you are going to end up with length of that linear convolution will be N1 plus N2 minus 1. That means the length keeps on increasing, right? Length is increasing in linear convolution, but in circular convolution, the length remains same. Just try to recall the periodic convolution over one period. X3 of n is the periodic convolution of x1 tilde of m and x2 tilde of n over the interval. And after doing periodic convolution, we are extracting 0 to n minus 1 interval. That's it. The periodic convolution, we are extracting 0 to n minus 1 interval in that one period of that periodic convolution. And we already saw, right, this one is same as circular shift, right? X tilde of n minus m is same as x2 of n minus m modulo n. We have seen this, right? That is same as circular shift, because see, x tilde of n plus 2 is same as x of n plus 2 modulo n. You can simply replace with that one, right? X2 tilde of n minus m, you can replace this with x2 of n minus m modulo n. And this can be written like this also. There is no problem for us, right? Because we already know that x1 tilde of m equals to x1 of m itself in the interval 0 to n minus 1. Both are identical in the interval 0 to n minus 1. And within 0 to n minus 1 interval, if you simply do m modulo n, you are going to end up with m itself, right? For example, consider n minus 1 modulo n, which is same as n minus 1 only, right? That means even if you keep this or if you don't keep it, there is no problem for us, right? And even this is a definition of this, right? We have seen s tilde of m equals to x of m modulo n by default. We are doing that only. This we have seen, right? Let's have a look into that. You can see that S tilde of n equals to x of n modulo n. We are simply using that property. That's it. We are simply doing that one, this to this conversion and this to this conversion. This is finite length sequence, this is periodic sequence, right? And m modulo n is same as m, where m from 0 to n minus 1, these two are same, there is no problem at all. You can replace this with m itself. And this is the circular shift by m units. Circular shift of the sequence, finite length sequence h2 by m units, circular shift. Or you can say periodic shift for this h2 tilde of n. This is a notation we are going to follow. X1 of n equals to h2. X3 of n equals to x1 of n circular convolution with x2 of n. Or sometimes you will try to follow within a circle notation capital N instead of star, we will try to go for capital N notation. It means the length of each and every sequence in this one is N, and this is called as N point circular convolution. Both are having length N, and the length we are going to get also capital N. And this is a property of DFT. If you do circular convolution in the time domain, in the DFT domain, they are getting multiplied, right? In the transform domain, they are getting multiplied. X1 of k into x2 of k, which is same as x2 of k into x1 of k. You can rewrite, right? There is no problem at all. This is just a multiplication of two scalars. It implies, see, this one is same as inverse DFT for h2 tilde of n circular convolution with, see, h2 of n circular convolution with x1 of n, right? That's why these two are equal. X1 of n circular convolution with x2 of n is same as h2 of n circular convolution with x1 of n. These two are identical, commutative, right? Let's look into one example for circular convolution. This is a finite length sequence, 0 to n minus 1 interval. This is h2 of m. And this is x1 of m. Where x1 of n is same as delta of n minus 1. You can see this. This is equals to delta of n minus 1 at 1, n equal to 1, m equal to 1 index. This is equals to 1, right? You can try to have a look into these graphs. Circular convolution of two rectangle pulses. Let's consider x1 of n equals to x2 of n, both are equal and equals to 1 in the interval 0 to l minus 1, otherwise 0. These are two rectangle pulses. Now let's try to find the circular convolution with the help of DFT. That can be done, right? Because see, if you do circular convolution in the time domain, that will be multiplied in the transform domain, right? In this case, we are trying to find the circular convolution using indirect method. Indirect method means first we will try to apply DFT for this one and DFT for this one. After that, we will try to multiply them, and later we will try to apply inverse transform for this to get circular convolution. In this case, both are same, right? X1 of k can be written like this one. Then you are going to end up with this. Now, x3 of k equals to n square for k equal to 0. Otherwise, that's 0, right? From this, you can have this. 10 into n, right? At k equal to 0, n square. Otherwise, that's 0. Now you can try to apply inverse transform for this one, inverse DFT for this one, to get this circular convolution, which is same as x3 of n equals to n from 0 to n minus 1 interval. If you simplify this one, you are going to end up with this expression. This is a computationally efficient way. You can have a look into the figures. This is x1 of n, this is h2 of n. Both are having the same length here, 0 to n minus 1, 0 to n minus 1. Now you are doing the circular convolution for both of them. Then you are going to end up with this expression, which is having the same length, right? Circular convolution also has the same length, 0 to n minus 1. It's a notation for n point circular convolution. Take the convolution of two rectangular pulses. Let's have that example once again. But this time, we'll try to append L zeros for that, L number of zeros for that one. Earlier, we considered N is same as L. But in this case, we are trying to consider this N equals to 2L. By appending L zeros, right? Actual length of this sequence is 0 to L minus 1. That is equals to 1. But what we are doing is from L to 2L minus 1. 2L means N. Up to L to N minus 1. We are appending zeros. We are augmenting L zeros. Now if you try to apply 2L point DFT for that one. 2L point DFT for that. N equals to L point DFT. Then you are going to end up with this. And if you have to find the circular convolution of those two, you can multiply them in the DFT domain. After that, you can take the inverse transform for that one. See x3 of k. And let's have a look into these graphs, try to analyze them. Other method for finding circular convolution. Let's try to consider two sequences. X1 of n is 1, 2, 0. X2 of n is 3, 5, 4. You can see the length of both sequences are same, right? Both are having a length of 3. Capital N equals to 3 in both of them. What we are doing here is, we will try to arrange one of the sequences in the clockwise. You can see this. We started here. So 0, 1. No, we started here. This is 1, 2, 0, right? This is 1, 2, 0 sequence. Clockwise, we are arranging them. This is 1, and this is 2. In the clockwise, we are arranging, and this is 0. And let's try to have a folded sequence. Folded sequence means there should be anti clockwise direction. You can see this circular convolution expression, right? The circular convolution expression, we are going to get folding, right? You can see this x1 of m, x2 of n minus m of n, which can be written like minus of m minus n, right? Minus of m minus n. First we are folding, after that we are shifting, right? Like in linear convolution. But this is circular fashion. Folded version of this one. Like we are trying to arrange this in the anti-clockwise direction. 3, 5, 4. 3, 5, and 4. The folded version of that one. And we are just inserting this inside this. Inside this we are keeping. That's fine. Once you keep this inside this one, then if you want to extract y of 0 from this one, y of 0, see y of n corresponds to circular convolution of x1 of n and x2 of n. Y of 0 can get straight away by point to point multiplication and addition of them. 3 into 1 plus 4 into 2 plus 5 into 0. This is y of 0. And if you want to get y of 1, try to rotate this inside one. For the inner one, try to rotate this clockwise by one sample, clockwise rotation. Then 3 will be shifted to this location, right? 3 will be facing towards 2. You can see this. Rotated by 1. Then this will become like 3, 4, 5. Now once again, try to multiply point by point and add them. 3 into 2 plus 4 into 0 plus 5 into 1. See y of 1. And if you want y of 2, and rotate this by one more sample. You already rotated by one sample, right? Now rotate by one more sample. Effectively, you are rotating this actual one by two samples, right? Then this will be 3, 4, 5. Try to multiply point by point and add them. That is same as y of 2. And we end up with circular conversion, right? because the length of this one is same as length of circular convolution. That's also having the same length 3, y of n also. We already got y of 0, y of 1, and y of 2. We can find the linear convolution with the help of circular convolution. That's possible. Let's see how. Let's consider two sequences, x1 of n of length 2, x2 of n of length 3. See, for linear convolution, the length of those two sequences can be unequal. There's no problem, right? For circular convolution, you need to maintain the same length. But if they are not of same length, for circular convolution, you may need to append zeros in order to make the length to be same. Otherwise, you can't perform circular convolution. For linear convolution, the two lengths need not be same, right? X1 of n length and x2 of n length need not be same. The length of this one is 2, length of this one is 3. The length of first one is m, length of second one is l. The length of that output y of n, which is linear convolution of x1 of n and x2 of n, that should be m plus l minus 1, right? According to linear convolution property. That means length of that linear convolution should be 2 plus 3 minus 1. That should be 4. You can see length is increasing, right? Length of that y of n sequence is more than both of them. If you want to perform linear convolution with the help of circular convolution, see, after circular convolution, you are going to end up with the same length, right? The length remains same. That means you should try to append, you should try to make sure that length of this one and length of this one is same as 4, which is same as m plus l minus 1, m plus l minus 1. Try to make sure that length of this one is m plus l minus 1. Length of this one also m plus l minus 1. If you want to make that one, simply append zeros. If you want to make it like length of 4, append 2 zeros here. See, after appending. Here you can append 1 zero to make it like length 4, right? Now if you try to apply circular convolution of this one, you are going to end up with some y of n of length 4 only once again. Okay, that is same as this one, right? If you do cyclic convolution. This is just a cyclic convolution of this sequence and this sequence. Let's arrange this in clockwise. See, 1, 2, 0, 0, right? 1, 2, 0, 0. And this, we are trying to arrange in the anti-clockwise. This is folded version, right? Folded sequence. 3, 5, 4, 0. 3, 5, 4, 0. And we are inserting this. After that, you want to have y of 0, simply multiply point by point and add 3 into 1 plus 2 into 0 plus 4 into 0 plus 5 into 0. The y of 0. You want y of 1. See y of 1. You can simply rotate this clockwise by one sample. Then you are going to end up with 3, 0. You are going to end up with this one. 3, 0, 4, 5. And multiply point by point and add. Same manner, if you want y of 2, this is y of 2. You can rotate this further by one more sample. Indirectly rotating this one by two samples, right? Multiply point by point and add. And we need to have one more sample y of 3, right? You can compute the y of 3 in the similar manner. Try to rotate this by one more sample, multiply point by point and add. Y of 3 is missing there in this figure. You can try to compute y of 3 also. These are some properties of DFT. You can have a look into this one. These almost look similar to properties of DFS and DTFT. Just with some change, right? In place of omega, we are having 2 pi k by n, right? And that 2 pi k by n, we are rebranding with k. We are neglecting 2 pi by n part. That's it. And in place of linear shift, you are going to get circular shift always. In place of linear convolution, you are going to get circular convolution always. You can have a look into this. Let's have a recap for linear convolution. Consider sequence x1 of n, whose length is l points, and the sequence x2 of n, whose length is p points. Suppose that we wish to combine these two sequences by linear convolution to obtain third sequence. This is a linear convolution operation, right? X3 of n equal to sigma m, x1 of n, x2 of n minus m. Let x1 of n not equal to 0 only in the interval 0 to l minus 1, x2 of n is not equal to 0 only in the interval 0 to p minus 1. In such scenarios, x3 of n can be non-zero only in the interval 0 to l plus p minus 2, because we need to add lower limits and upper limits, right? 0 plus 0 is 0, l minus 1 plus p minus 1 is same as l plus p minus 2. X3 of n can be non-zero only in this interval, if that is linear convolution. And the length of this particular sequence is l plus p minus 1, the imaginary length of the sequence x3 of n, resulting from linear convolution. The method to compute linear convolution with the help of DFT. See, with the help of DFT, we can compute cyclic convolution, right? If we simply multiply them in the DFT domain, x1 of k into h2 of k, then we are going to end up with x1 of n cyclic convolution with x2 of n, right? Both are having the same length. But there is no direct way to compute linear convolution with the help of DFT. There is a method to compute cyclic convolution. Now we will try to make use of cyclic convolution to get linear convolution. We already saw that we can append zeros to x1 of n and x2 of n. We can append zeros, right? And after that, we can do cyclic convolution. That output is same as linear convolution output. Both are same. Let append zeros. And so that we can try to make the length of both sequences will be L plus P minus 1. And we know that we can compute cyclic convolution with the help of DFT, multiplying the frequency domain. After that, we can apply inverse DFT. Inverse DFT. Then you can get cyclic convolution. After appending zeros, that is similar linear convolution, right? Indirectly. This DFT can be computed with the help of some fast Fourier transform algorithms. This is FFT, means fast Fourier transform. So we'll try to compute DFT only. The output of DFT is same as the output of FFT. But time required for computation is less for FFT as compared to time required to compute directly with the help of DFT. This computation time is less compared to this one, but the output we are going to get from both is same. Because these FFT algorithms are available, it is computationally efficient to implement a convolution of two sequences by the following process. Let's consider two finite length sequences, x1 of n length L, x2 of n length P. This is step one. Compute endpoint DFTs x1 of k and x2 of k for two sequences x1 of n and x2 of n respectively, where n equal to L plus P minus 1. It means that we are trying to append zeros, right? See, we can say this, the length of this one is L only. But we are trying to make it like length n. N equals to L plus P minus 1. That means we are trying to append P minus 1 zeros to this sequence. In the same manner, the length of this one is P only. But we are trying to make it like length n equals to L plus P minus 1. It means that we are trying to append L zeros to this sequence. We are trying to do zero padding at the end. And after that, we are applying DFTs for both of them after zero padding, endpoint DFT, where n equals to L plus P minus 1. And once you compute DFTs for them, you can simply take the product, right? X3 of k equals to x1 of k into h2 of k. And if you apply inverse transform or inverse DFT for this one, then we are going to end up with this one. X3 of n equals to x1 of n linear convolution with h2 of n, where these two are the actual sequences, the other sequences. Circular convolution gets converted to linear convolution, right, with the help of this zero padding. We have seen one example also. Can you cross check this one? Try to cross check this with the help of linear convolution of this one and this one directly. Here we have done with the help of circular convolution, right? Try to do the linear convolution of this sequence directly and cross check these four values, y of 0 to y of 3, with these four values after convolution. They will be exactly identical. Implementing an LTI system using the DFT. Suppose the input sequence x of n is of finite length, like L point input sequence, and impulse response h of n is P point impulse response. Then you can try to implement the convolution, linear convolution, with the help of DFT, right? This we got to know just now. We already know that if the input is x of n, impulse response is h of n, the response we are going to get, that y of n equals to x of n linear convolution with h of n, right? Linear convolution, when that is LTI system. And we know the indirect way to compute linear convolution, right? First you will try to go for zero padding. After that you can find DFT for both of them. Once you found DFT, you can multiply point by point. After that you can find inverse DFT to get back to linear convolution. And you can try to have a look into these slides, block convolution. If you are interested, you can go through this one. This may not be part of syllabus, but it's quite interesting. Still, try to discuss about practicality, practical implementation. Thank you.